So if you've been a fan of the channel for a while now, you probably know that I am a huge proponent of Lightroom's cloud-based ecosystem. I think Lightroom Classic is great. I've used Lightroom Classic since the early beta days, like many of you. But when Lightroom came out, I moved to that. And I still think there is a subset of photographers who just think that it is not possible to do power editing or creative editing using a mobile device like an iPad. And so in this video, what I want to do is show you just a very straightforward editing workflow using Lightroom and Photoshop on my iPad Pro. This is just an M1 iPad Pro. I bought it used a few months ago, but you can get this same editing process done on just about any iPad. So you don't have to go out and get the latest and greatest. My point though is I want to show you that actually there are a ton of things that you can do creatively and what you would consider power edits with Lightroom and Photoshop on the iPad. So let's jump in. All right, so I created this album here and I just copied one of my photos from way back when I went to Iceland. If I go to the info view here, you can see it was taken in February 2015. And you can see here, this is the unedited photo. I took it with my Sony a7R and the 16 to 35 millimeter F4 because I don't think the 2.8 lens was even available, nor was a newer version of the a7R. So here's the photo, and if I tap and hold, you can see that this is the original photo. Normally, if you tap and hold in Lightroom, it will toggle between the edited state and the original state. And so what I want to do is walk you through my editing workflow for this photo. So to start, I'll go to the editing toolbar over here, and I will open up Light. Now, you might notice that there is a piece of information that's very critical for photographers that's not shown, and that's the histogram. In order to access the histogram, it's kind of hidden as far as the gesture is concerned, but if you double tap once, you'll see an info view here, and if you tap through here, you can toggle between different info views. But if you double tap again, there is your histogram. So this is important, especially for a photo like this, if you're editing darker or night photos, because you really need to see how the tone falls in your photo. And so what I'll do is start by opening up the exposure a little bit here. And then once I get it to a pretty decent place where now most of the tones are kind of in the shadows range, I'm gonna take the white slider here and I'm gonna move my white point until it almost hits the end of the histogram on the right there. You can see how bright it got. The other thing I'm gonna do is open up my highlights. And then I'm gonna do the same thing with the black slider and the shadow. So I'm gonna open up the black point a little bit here and open up the shadows. And so now you can see we have a properly exposed photo. And like I showed you before, if I tap and hold, there is the original unedited photo. And then this is what we did with just a few sliders. The other thing that I like to do pretty much at the beginning, if not first usually, is go to the optics section here and enable lens correction. So you can see if I toggle it pretty quickly, you see how it does a nice job of removing the little bit of barrel distortion from the 16 to 35 millimeter lens, as well as a little bit of that lens vignette. All right, now I want to make some localized edits. So I want to make some edits to the sky and to the foreground. To do that, fortunately, Lightroom Mobile has some of the most powerful masking tools that I've ever seen, especially on a mobile device, and they are called adaptive masks. So what I mean by that is if I go ahead and I swipe out here, you can see there's a button to create a new mask. So I'm going to tap on that. And what adaptive means is that if I tap on select sky on this photo, Lightroom will analyze the photo and it will detect the sky automatically. And if I go to a different image with a completely different sky and I tap select sky, it will detect the sky for that photo. So that's what it means by being adaptive. It adapts to the contents of the photo. So let's go ahead here and tap on select sky. Now, I have a little bit of a shortcut to get an even cleaner sky selection. And unfortunately on Lightroom, the masking color doesn't make it super easy to show you, but trust me, do this if you're gonna do a select sky. First thing what you'll want to do is swipe this toolbar out over here and then tap on subtract from mask one and tap select sky. So that probably doesn't make sense, right? Like we just went and we tapped on select sky and then we tapped on subtract, which is remove. And then we said, remove the sky that we just selected. I know, trust me, if you do this one thing next, it actually makes a huge difference. So what I mean by that is with this sky to subtraction layer selected, and you can see there it's selected, what you'll wanna do is on the bottom left, If I swipe out here, you'll see there's a button called invert. We're going to tap on that. Now you'll see the mask is back, but again, on mobile, it's a little bit difficult to see because of the color of the overlay, but trust me, it is a cleaner mask. In fact, I've done other videos where I showed this in action, and without a doubt, the mask is significantly cleaner. So let's get back to it. Now with the mask selected, what I can do is make edits only to the sky. And I'm not going to do too many things. In fact, I'm just going to go to the effect section here, and I'm going to take dehaze, and I'm going to start dragging on that because I find the dehaze slider works so well with skies. And the other thing I can do here is go to color and add a little bit of a saturation boost, not too much, because these kind of northern light skies are already very colorful and you don't want to get it too strong. And so now that I have finished editing the sky, I want to make a few edits to the foreground. And the easiest way for me to do that is if I swipe out again, and then I go to the mask one, the top layer here, and I tap on the ellipse, there's an option called duplicate and invert mask one, which instantly creates a new mask of the opposite of the sky. So now we have this really clean foreground selection. Now, of course, if you want to make it easier to identify what you're working with, you can tap over here and tap on rename. And so I can delete this here and just call it foreground. Tap OK, and I can do the same thing with the first mask, rename that, delete it, and we'll call it sky. So now it's easier to visualize what we're working on. The reason why the underlying selections are called sky one, sky two is because that's the name of the selection itself. It's not the name of the layer, so don't get confused with that. It's just basically when you go to create new, because I used select sky for this selection, that's what it's called. But the key here is to know that the top layer, that's the name of the mask. So for the foreground, all I want to do is add a little bit more detail. So I'll go over here to effects. I'll add a little bit of clarity and a little bit of texture. And that's pretty much all I want to do for the foreground. So I'm going to tap done on the bottom right here to get me out of the mask view. Now the last global change that I want to make is to the tone curve. And so to do that, I'm going to tap on the light section here and then tap on the tone curve button. I'll make sure that I am on the tone mode, not one of the color modes here, which are the red, green, and blue, or the parametric mode, which is this button. I just want to be right here. And I'm going to start by tapping right here at this intersection and dragging down to add a little bit more of a deeper shadow, tapping up here, bring up the highlights, and then adjusting the mid-tone right there. And the last thing I'm going to do is tap on the black point, which is on the bottom left corner. I'm going to drag up, and that's going to bring some gray into the darkest parts of the photo, so it gives it a little bit of a vintagey look, which I think works really well here. Now that I'm done, I'll tap on the tone curve button again to get rid of it. Now you might be wondering, Brian, why didn't you get a custom white balance? That's usually one of the first things that I do, especially when working with RAW files, but getting a custom white balance is something that you have to be careful with, especially when you're working in, I would say, maybe distinctive light or challenging light. So here with this photo, this was taken at night. And as you can see, the light is very, very challenging because we've got the color from the northern lights as well as just the natural color from the nighttime. So let me show you what would happen, though, if I went and I applied a custom white balance. So under color here, I'm going to tap on the white balance dropper. And I'll put it on an area which should be gray. So somewhere right around there. Do you see what happens? It does exactly what it's supposed to do. It's resetting what should be neutral gray, but at the same time, it removes that really nice natural color cast from the scene. So watch, if I tap the check mark, if I undo, you see here is kind of the more natural tone. And if I redo, because we use the custom white balance now, we've gotten rid of it and it just looks a bit too cool for me. Of course, I can readjust by using the temperature slider, but I find that the shot as is with the camera, it just looks good. So that's why I'm not using a custom white balance. And so once again, if I tap and hold over here, you can see there's our original photo. In fact, let me just tap to get a full screen view. If I tap and hold, there is the original. And here, I mean, we were able to get some really awesome edits made right on the iPad using Lightroom. There is even more that we can do, though, because we also have access to Photoshop on the iPad, and that gives us some more creative ways to manipulate and edit the photo. Now, before we jump into that, just give me like 30 seconds to tell you about my new course that is now out. It's available. It's called Lightroom Everywhere. So if you're even remotely interested in this kind of editing workflow, whether you're using Lightroom on your desktop, your iPad, your iPhone, your Android device, whatever, if you want to make the most out of your Adobe subscription, please check out this course. The link is in the description below. I go over absolutely everything there is to know about using Lightroom's cloud-based ecosystem, including how it works with Photoshop on the iPad. And there are over 40 video lessons in the course, totaling over 8 hours of easy-paced instruction. You will learn absolutely everything you need to know about using Lightroom Everywhere. So again, links in the description, and let's get back to it. All right, so I mentioned that we can do even more. So we just did everything in Lightroom. Again, I think that what we started with and what we ended with is really great, but I do want to have a little bit more fun. Fortunately, Adobe does have a version of Photoshop for the iPad that is quite functional, and I'm going to show you how it can fit into this workflow. Before you send your photo from Lightroom to Photoshop, the first thing you'll want to do is tap on the cloud icon. And what's important is to see what kind of photo file you have locally. So you might just have a smart preview, which will show smart preview. And if that's the case, you'll have the option to download the original file locally. I already did that in advance. Even if you don't do that manually, when you send your photo to Photoshop, Lightroom will automatically start downloading the original from the cloud. So you don't have to worry about it. Now, because the full resolution original file is already downloadable locally, to send the photo to Photoshop, all you have to do is tap on the share button here, and you'll see there is an option, edit in Photoshop. So I will tap that now. And you'll see that a PSD file will be created and sent over to Photoshop. All right, so here we are in Photoshop. And again, I'm not saying that this is like a full-on replacement to the desktop version of Photoshop, just like I wouldn't say that the Lightroom mobile version is a complete replacement to Lightroom on the desktop. There are still things that are desktop only. Still, there's a ton of cool things that you can do. So let me show you. Generally, the first thing I do before starting any editing is duplicate the original layer just so that I have a backup copy. To do that, I'm going to tap on this ellipse here and tap on duplicate layer. Now, what I want to do is pretty straightforward, but it's not something you can do in Lightroom. And that is, I want to adjust the scale of those mountains in the background. I also want to adjust the scale of the frozen body of water in the foreground, but I don't want to crop in. I want to keep the full resolution, basically this aspect ratio and this pixel count. So let me show you how to do that. It's actually pretty straightforward. First thing we're going to do is tap here on the selection tool and then tap again so you can see the other options. I'm going to start by tapping on the marquee rectangle. And all I want to do is make a selection just of this area here, because that's what I want to expand. So with that selection made, I'm going to tap on the transform tool here. I'm going to zoom out just so we can see more of the image. And I'm going to drag from the top right corner here so you can see how we are basically making the mountain range and the sky even larger. So we're making the northern lights more prominent. And it looks like the mountain range just looks a lot larger, and it looks as if we are much closer. So now let me go ahead and tap done and zoom in here. And let me just tap on deselect on the bottom here. And so let me go ahead and hide that layer so you can see what the original looks like. And until you make the edit, you don't even think about it. Like, you don't think about how small and how far away those mountains look until you do something like this, where now the mountain range just kind of takes upon the entire length of the composition, and it just looks more impressive. The northern lights have more of a presence compared to the original here, where they kind of fall off towards the top. And so little things like this, I think, are just, I don't know, it's super easy to do in Photoshop, but it makes the photo more impactful. And so I want to do the exact same thing with the foreground. So what I'm going to do is just make a selection here of just the frozen body of water. So just like that. Then let's go to the transform tool here. And this, I'm just going to stretch out from the side here until basically the body of water kind of is centered and takes the full width of the image. I'll tap done and tap deselect. And so here you can see, let's go to the original here. And then with just a few changes, to me, this looks like a lot more impressive of a composition. And the reason why I like this particular edit is because even though I took the photo with a 16 to 35 millimeter lens, by making these two different transform selections, It looks like I used a zoom lens or a telephoto lens, like a 24 to 70 or 70 to 200. And what's really great is here, you kind of don't have any sort of lens compression or a relationship from the foreground to the background. Everything just looks far away. But with this, you definitely have a little bit more of that kind of lens compression feel to it, which I think is fantastic. So that's all I wanted to use Photoshop for. It's pretty straightforward, but as you can see, it's an effective edit. So now that I'm done, all I need to do is tap on the Send to Lightroom button on the top left, and it'll bring me back to Lightroom. And there you go. There is the new photo that we created. It's right over here. And if I swipe over, you can see here is the original photo. This is the edited photo. There are a few things that I might still want to do, just last minute things like go to detail here and then add a little bit of sharpening. So just a little bit of sharpening here, then make sure that sharpening is not applied to areas like the sky. It's just applied to high contrast edges. And then let's go to effects here and add a post crop vignette just to draw the eye more towards that center of the frame. And then if we back out here, you can see that Lightroom is automatically uploading that PSD file that was created. It'll make itself available on all of the other devices that you're logged into with your Adobe ID, and it'll also be backed up to the cloud, so you don't have to worry. So I hope this kind of inspires you and kind of gives you some ideas and makes you excited to give Lightroom and Photoshop a shot on mobile devices, because it really is powerful if you just allow yourself to enjoy it and not get hung up on the things that may not be available at the time, because there really is a ton that you can do. I've been using this for a long time, and trust me, I take my photography just as seriously as anybody else. I don't find that I am at really any sort of disadvantage or loss or a handicap because I'm using mobile devices. And that's kind of the message that I want to share with you. Now, again, if you are interested in learning everything there is to know about using Lightroom Everywhere, please check out my course. The link is in the description below. You'll definitely learn a ton from it. And if you want to learn even more interesting things that you can do between Lightroom and Photoshop on the iPad, check out this video. Thanks a lot, everyone.